So many times. I remember us. When we first got into the faith move, you know, we started hearing about planting the seed and that kind of stuff, you know. Well, you know, our minds, coming from the background that we came from, you know, it just didn't sit well with us, all that kind of seed planting and all that, you know, didn't make sense with us and all. So it took a while, you know. And back then, we were struggling, you know, and the devil was fighting us every kind of way. And we would hear a good word one day, you know, and we'd say, okay, well we're going to try that, you know, or we're going to do that, you know, and we would do this or that. And we would, you know, we would wait a day or two, you know, like that person did. We'd wait a day or two. And you know, if you're believing God for some kind of bill to be paid, you know, or if you're believing God for a healing in your body, you know, you begin to kind of get antsy about things sometimes, you know. Like that little kid, he was a little girl or a little boy?
It's a frightened little boy.
Like that little fella did, you know. And you get antsy about it, you know. And you go to wonder when God going to do it, you know. And why ain't he done it? And you know, and man, you know, the day's coming. I got to have that. I got to have this money. Or, you know, Lord, I'm still sick. I'm still, you know. And the way that you keep watering that seed, whether it be for healing, whether it be for finances, whether it be for a new car, whether it be for a new mixer, whether it be for a new chair, whatever it is, you begin to confess the word of God over it, like Donna said.
Yeah.
You see? And see, that does two things. That keeps the angels coming towards you with it. And that keeps your faith built up.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
I tell you, if you've never seen the movie Faith Like Potatoes, has any of you, I know some of you seen it.
I have seen part of it, I've seen it.
Huh?
You haven't seen all of it? I haven't.
Yeah, we got it here too. I suggest everybody watch that. It is so good. The guy, at the end of it, you know, it's about a farmer in Africa, and he gets saved, and he is radically saved. You know what radically saved is? He's on fire for God, and I mean, he puts his faith out and believes God for things. You know? Well, the guy tells him to plant some potatoes. Well, I think it was in that region. It was a drought, you know, and you don't plant potatoes in a drought. And everybody was telling him, man, you're doing the craziest thing there is, you know, planting taters this year. It's a drought. They're so dry, they're never going to grow. But God had told him to plant potatoes. And he moved and acted on God's word, what he heard in his heart that God told him. Planted those potatoes. And to look out there and then with the natural eye, the plants on top of the ground had wilted. It was dust out there. And people said, man, there ain't no potatoes. Ain't no way there's going to be potatoes out there. You know, I'm telling y'all the movie, but you'll have to watch it and really get the whole thing. Anyway, you know, he just, and they would go to him and say, man, what you going to do? Oh, I'm going to believe God. Well, when you going to dig one? When it's the right time, you know, and he kept believing God. They said, you know, there ain't no potatoes out there. Look at the dust, man. And come time to dig the potatoes. Barren ground out there, man. I mean, it was so dry. You know, people had tried to get him to go, man, you ought to just go out there and just dig up and see if there's anything down there. And that's why they call it faith like potatoes, because you can't see. You cannot see that there's potatoes down there. And in the natural, with the natural eye, it looked like there was nothing down there. Are you hearing me? There's a lot of times with your natural eye and your natural senses, it's going to look like that God's not coming through for you, and the devil's going to lie to you, and he's going to tell you, you know, just like he did Eve, well, God's this and God that, and he's not going to do it for you. But if you have believed something in your heart, you got to stand on it, and you got to keep just believing, mm-hmm. And you got to keep speaking with your mouth. Basically, the end results.
Yeah.
And that's what he told him. He said, no, We're not digging until it's time to dig. And when it's time to dig, we're going to dig, and there's going to be potatoes there.
Amen.
And when they went to digging, there was potatoes, just big. He had such an enormous amount of potatoes that year, nobody else would grow anything. Nobody, I mean, everybody else went broke, but he got rich that year.
Yeah.
He believed God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Anyway, that's another. That's something else there. This morning, God just wanted me to talk about. The title of it is "Fear Will Immobilize You." Fear will paralyze you. I mean, when you get in fear, you just like you can't go forward anymore. You can't do nothing for being in fear. Fear will grip you. Amen.
Yeah.
the subject is fear and what it will do to you and how it will stop you from moving forward. Let's turn over to 1 Samuel chapter 17. I want to show you how when fear grips you, it'll stop you in your tracks and you can't go nowhere because of fear. And we're just going to kind of move with the Holy Spirit here and let Him minister. We're pretty much going to stay in this passage here, unless He tells us to go somewhere else. But 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 10 and 11, and then 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 24. We're talking about fear stopping you, fear gripping you. This is where the army of Israel, that went out to fight against the Philistines, and it's where David, he went down and ends up killing Goliath. This is what this story is all about, and giant would come out every day and holler at Goliath. I mean, Goliath would come out and holler and shout at the armies of Israel. And they got in such great fear. Look in verses 10 and 11. The Philistines said, and this is Goliath talking. The Philistine said, "This day I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other." On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. The whole army of Israel was dismayed and terrified. And then look over here. This is another time that Goliath came out shouting at him. Verse 24 says, "When the Israelite," well, let's see. "As he was talking," as David was talking with them, Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance. And David heard it. When the Israelites saw the man, they all ran from him in great fear. Hallelujah. Father, I just thank you today for your word. Father, I thank you that as you anoint your servant today, Lord, that the words that you once spoke, what you want the church to hear, Lord, you will speak through me. By faith, I yield myself to you as an instrument that you can use, Lord. I open my mouth and you fill it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. How many of us have ever experienced some kind of fear that would just stop you in your tracks? But then there's a fear we may get a word that we got a bill coming due and we don't have no money to pay it. And if you don't pay it, we're going to take your house. We're going to take this. We're going to take your car. Fear can grip you. Amen. That's the kind of fear that I want us to get a hold of. Yes, there's a fear of you and you're standing, you know, somewhere or another, and somebody come running at you, you know, and, you know, or you know, like one time I remember I was in Sulphur there on Beamish Parkway, and there's a railroad track crosses, right, and there's a building right there by the crossing. And you can't see down that way until basically you're fixing to cross the track. And I'm going up there, you know, and the signs are not down or anything. But I'm pulling across there. You know, I come through the light, and I'm probably doing about 20 or so, you know. And I look that way, and as I look, there that spotlight is about like here to y'all's cars out there from, you know. And if he would have blown the horn, I probably would have had a heart attack. When I looked, all I seen was train, and there was no stopping, and I'm like, oh, you know. I didn't realize he was stopped. He wasn't moving. But you talk about fear. I got scared, man. Amen. And that's one kind of fear. But I'm talking about a fear that will grip you because of, like I said, looking at something that maybe... You know, saints, well, let me just go on here with what I got wrote down. What builds fear is talking up whatever's in front of you, what it looks like, how big it is. Amen?
Yeah.
We bad about doing that. Listen to what the Israelites did. Look in verse 17 and 25. Now if the Israelites had been saying, do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. See, every day they was talking about him. They was talking about, look how he comes out before us. Look at that Joker's head, because you can see back in here in another place they tell about how big he was, how big his shoulders was, how big his spear was. See, they were seeing all that. He would step out there, and he was big, man. He would step out on that line, and all they seen was this big guy. And they were like, I mean, running from all the whole Israelite army, basically running from that one giant, that one person. But so many times, that's what we'll do. We'll turn tail and run, because the devil will come out there. And he'll go to shouting at us about something, you know, and I'm going to take your head off, and I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, you know. The word cancer, if people hear the word cancer and fear will grip you. I've never had the word cancer spoken to me. I know Miss Renee has. I don't know if any of the rest of you had, but it'll grip you. I guarantee you it would. Why? Why would it grip you so bad? Because it has been built up so big to where it is a killer. And it is a killer. And they'll tell you there's some cancers that have no cure. I got news for you. There's nothing uncurable.
That's right.
There's nothing that can't be cured. How do I know that? Because Jesus bore it on the cross for us. And by his stripes, we've been healed of it. That's a lie from the devil that says that you've got an incurable disease. You know, they say that HIV is incurable. Well, I got news for you. It ain't. If you believe God, it ain't.
Amen?
Nothing is impossible to him that believes.
That's right.
Amen? Nothing. But people will talk about cancer. Or we'll tell you, know, not just cancer. You know, there's leprosy. There is leukemia. There's all kinds of diseases out there that kill. And people will go to talking about it. And the first news you know, it's so big. And man, it's killed. You know, you get in a group of people. I remember Shane talked a little bit about this a while back. You get in a group of people, I guarantee you, I could go telling you about, man, I remember the time I got that finger in the table saw. And man, you talk about hurt. And I'm telling the story, somebody's sitting there waiting for me to shut up so they can get you. Man, I remember when I got this leg in a chainsaw. We do that. You know how I know we do that? Because I do it. I'm guilty of the same thing. Me and the preacher. Men really bad about it, man. They want to talk. Hey, man, you think that was bad? Hey, when I hurt that knee right there, I want you to know, buddy, because that was some pain right there, man. What are we doing? We're glorifying the devil, man. Oh, that joker's bad now. That's why fear gets such a grip on us, because we build it up so bad. We just build up whatever's in front of, whatever's coming at. We made it so bad.
Yep.
You think about how bad, man, if you got this, somebody told you, man, you got HIV. That's a death sentence, really. You know, according to the medical statistics, and you know what the medical community says and all, you know, you got HIV, but you don't hurt nothing we do, man. But there is something. You can believe God.
Right.
Now, is it going to be easy? I'm not saying it's going to be easy, because the devil's going to fight you. He's going to fight you. He wants to take you out. He don't care if you're saved. He don't care if you're saved. He don't care if he takes you out before your time. He wants to take you out, because if he can take you out before your time, then there's people that God's got in line for you to minister to, for you to talk to. Are you hearing me? There's people that he wants you, that God's got lined up for you to talk to and minister to get saved. And if he can take you out, then he's accomplished keeping you from doing what God wanted you to do. Did you lose? No, you didn't lose. Like my son Joshua, I believe there was all kind of people set in his path that he would have ministered to. Because that boy had an anointing on him. I mean, you know, and he would talk to people. Should I know this man? When them two would get together and talk, Joshua told me, he said, man, we just sit and talk sometimes for hours, you know. And Shane's needing to work, you know. That was the way he was. He loved to talk about the Lord, you know. He did.
Amen.
But what I'm saying is, see, the devil got to take him out when he was 25 years old. See, God's word says, with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. Amen. And see, there's no way that I believe that was a long life for him. But I also know that Joshua didn't lose, Joshua gained. Why? Because he ain't got to face this Obama mania thing right now. Amen? Man, he ain't worried about it no more. Amen? He didn't lose. But there was people in his path that God had set before him that I believe he was going to minister to. Now, did it throw a kink in God's plan? No. Yes, Joshua won't do it, but God will get somebody else. He'll just have to double chain up, maybe. You know? Nothing the devil does puts God in emergency mode. How many of you know God never gets in emergency mode?
Right.
It's just like I said a while ago. He's sitting there. And he's waiting on us.
That's right.
He's waiting on us. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. I wrote this down. Cancer is a Goliath of today, and it can't be beaten if fear is in control.
Amen. That's right, yeah.
How many, are you hearing me? I mean, you think about what Goliath was doing. Every day he would come out and he would get out there and he'd, he'd go shout, rrr, rrr, rrr. You know, he's big, man, they look like, oh, you putting a head on that yeller, man. Ooh! Look at that spear he's carrying. God! He's so big. Well, see, cancer does that to people. Every day he'll come out and holler. Aah! You know, especially if you've got it. Oh, Miss Renee, if you've had it or you got it, it's going to holler at you. The devil's going to use it to get in your mind and try to get you in fear.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen? So that's what you got to do when you hear those things, when you hear him trying to get in your head and get you in fear. That's when you got to get in your mouth and say, hey!
Come on.
Jesus done bore that for me.
Amen.
Jesus redeemed me from that. I'm not taking that. I'm sending it back to you. That's what I do.
Amen.
When a headache tries to come on me, you start doing this. Don't start trying it. Start doing it. Some kind of symptom will try to come on you. Flu symptom. Any kind of sickness try to come on you. You just say, no, devil, you ain't putting that on me. I turn it around. I send it back to you. You're going to be sick, not me. I put it back on you.
Amen.
Send it back to me.
Amen.
There's a stamp that says return to sender. Say, I stamped that return to sender. You ain't putting that on me. I send it back to you. And he'll try something else. He'll try sending something else your way. You just got to keep on.
Yep.
See, as long as you're walking on this earth, breathing this air, as long as you're on the top side of the grass, you're going to deal with the devil. You're going to have to put him in his place.
That's it.
You're going to have to walk in the victory that God and that Jesus got for you.
That's it. Amen.
Just like I said that week before last, or last, whenever it was. Abundant life is ours to possess. But it's up to us to possess it.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And if you are in fear, you will not possess it. You see, the Israelite army was not possessing the land that the Philistines were holding. Are you hearing me? Mm-hmm. They were cowered down. Now you think about this. See how to say this. Because people, a lot of times people think that they're helping someone when. Well, I'll just use this example because there are some people that is close to us that we heard had a cancer. And, you know, you tend to want to say, oh, we be praying for you. Oh, I know it's bad. And look, I don't want you to get offended. Don't think I have sympathy for people. Miss Renee, don't you think that, you know. Because I want to be careful how I say this, but I want you to see this is how the devil does. Oh, sister, I'm telling you, we're praying for you. I know it's so bad, but you can make it, though, sister. It's just, and they go to petting you, and they go to patting you, and you know, and instead of saying, well, sister, I know it's rough, but you know God redeemed you from that.
Yeah.
Did you know that by his stripes you was healed?
Yeah.
Hey, man, and you begin to speak words of comfort. You begin to speak words of encouragement, I mean, to them.
Yeah.
And you begin to lift them up, and you begin to lift their faith up, and you start, if you hook up with their faith, if you find out what they're believing, and quit trying to water down in self-pity mode, and get them up.
Yeah.
And say, hey, he's out there, but let's me and you go towards him.
Yeah.
So we can take that joker out.
Yeah.
Sometimes people get, you know, they get in a battle like that, and we need to hook up with them.
Yeah.
We need, but don't go in there feeling sorry for them.
Yeah.
That's what our natural nature wants to do, but you got to go in there and you got to pick them up and say, hey, we can beat this.
Yeah.
By the blood of Jesus, You know, because Jesus shed his blood for us, we can beat this. Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
You can't walk in fear. But you see, are you understanding? I don't think I'm getting a picture across to you, because this is where the body of Christ is missing it. They're just missing it. They're seeing these sicknesses and all. And hospitals are full of sick people. I know that. We see sickness all the time. But I want you to know that it's because there's an enemy out there, and we're fighting that enemy. You see, every day the Israelite army would come out and line up, and Goliath would come out there and shout at them, and they'd turn tail and run. And when the enemy goes to hollering, instead of the church getting up and saying, "You holler, but bless God, we're going forward."
Yeah.
Yeah. You holler, I don't care. We're going forward. I mean, the church does in some things. You know, I'm so glad that the church is standing up on this abortion issue and these gay rights issues. You know, there's a lot of pastors and all standing up and fighting against that, you know, and making our voice heard now. But there's so much more that we've got to stand against. Are you here?
Amen.
And I don't think that I'm even getting it said right the way I feel it, but the devil is, instead of us getting up and advancing towards, we're cowering down.
Yeah.
We're hunkering down and acting like that it's, you know, we can't. But let's move on here and see what David did. I wrote this. We can see the Israelite army was in such fear that they would run in fear when Goliath would come out. You can't beat your enemy if you run from him. You must go out and confront him and take him on. And take him on. What did David do? One thing David did, one thing David did is remember who he was.
Amen.
Amen. Look at 1 Samuel 17:26. And it's the last part of this that I want you to see. I'll go ahead and read the whole verse, but it's the last part of it I want you to see. David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" See, when he said this uncircumcised Philistine, he was recognizing that I've got a covenant, we've got covenant, and he don't.
Yep. Yeah.
See, he remembered who he was.
Yeah.
I've got covenant with God. See, he did because he said uncircumcised. He recognized the covenant that God had made with Abraham.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? Sometimes you've got to remember who you are and whose you are.
Yes, amen.
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 David had covenant and Goliath didn't. That's what David was rehearsing. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he would defy the armies of the living God? Who is this devil trying to put sickness on me when Jesus has already defeated him? He has already bore my sicknesses. He's already carried my disease. Who is this fella that's trying to put this cancer on me? Who is this fella that's trying to put this emphysema on me? Who is this fella that's trying to take me out before my time?
Amen.
Are you hearing me? You got to use your mouth.
Come on.
That's how you fight the enemy, was with your mouth. You confess what you believe.
Yeah, amen.
If you believe it, speak it.
Come on.
See, the devil don't want you speaking what you believe. You can believe it all day long. But when you start speaking it, It's going to change things.
Amen.
Are you hearing me? I mean, I know y'all heard me tell a story about how she rode around in that little old Justy one summer. I mean, hot as all get out. She just kept saying, thank you, Lord, for a car with the coldest air in town. And she kept confessing that. She kept saying it all summer long. She kept believing that and speaking it. Confessing, I have a car with the coldest air in town. Now, she wasn't just saying something that she's going, because this is where people, I'm going to get this, I'm going to get that. It's what you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth.
Yeah.
You can go around confessing, I'm going to get a pair of alligator shoes. I'm going to get a pair of alligator shoes. Well, what do you need alligator shoes for? I got news for you. Every alligator I've ever seen is barefooted. You don't have shoes. But you see, sometimes we go to confessing things that don't make a bit of sense, and we know we ain't really believing in our heart about it. Mm-hmm. And then when it never happens, well, I know, I'm believing, I was in faith. No, you wasn't. But I got news for you. If you get in faith and you confess it with your mouth and you believe it in your heart, it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Every time.
Yeah.
Well, now, no, it don't, brother, because I believe this and I confess this right on the end, and it never did happen. Well, you didn't really believe it. Because if God's Word says it.
That's right.
It says if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart. I know it's talking about Jesus, but it's also talking about what you believe in your heart and speak out your mouth. It will be done. Because it also says in Mark 11, 22-23, you can have what you say.
Yeah.
And I got news for you. You're going to have what you say, good or bad.
Yeah, that's right.
You see, that's what people don't understand. These people that talk about the blab it and grab it people, they're just as guilty of being blab it and grab it people as we are. They just blab and grab the wrong thing.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, brother, if it's going to happen to anybody, it's going to happen to me. I tell you, every year when the flu comes around, I'm going to get it. I know it. Every year it never fails. I mean to tell you, you can mark it down like clockwork. I'm going to get it. Well, what are they doing?
He's blabbing and grabbing.
He's believing, man, that he's going to get the flu. Well, now, you say you never get the flu. You can't. How stupid are you to stand there and say that you're never going to get the flu? Well, I'm going to say it. I'm going to say it. I never get the flu. And when it comes around every year, I say, I ain't getting that stuff, and I ain't going to take no flu shot either. The flu shot I take is Psalms 91.
Amen.
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 That's right.
It ain't coming near my dwelling. That's what the Word of God says.
That's it.
Stand on the Word of God. Quote the Word of God. And when it don't look like it's happened, don't go dig it up, my darling. You pour a little more water on it. Water of the Word. You need a little more finances. My God shall supply all my needs according to His riches in glory. You know, y'all heard me shouting up here this morning, praising God. I was speaking, you know why? Because I made a decision. I'm going to start confessing and talking and shouting out things that I'm believing God. I just believe that He's made me the head and not the tail. I believe that I'm above and not beneath.
Amen. Amen.
But you know, we get this mental block when we begin to hear people saying things like that. Well, he wants to be rich. Well, I do. But I consider myself rich already. You know? But if I can get a little more money, I'm fine with that. But that ain't what I'm talking about. You know, there's some of the richest people. Look at old Donald Trump, how unhappy he is. Look at Elvis Presley, how he died so miserably. All these people, these movie stars and these singing stars and all, got all kind of money. But they're not happy. And you see, that's not the blessings of God. But man, when you go to talking about the blessings, it's money. That's what people see. You go to talking about planting seed, money. That's what people see. I heard a preacher, Dwayne Sherrod, out of Oklahoma. He preached a message on the blessings of God. Money is just a byproduct of the blessings of God.
Amen.
It's just a byproduct. And I heard it, you like this. I think it was Brother Hagin said the other day, faith is how you buy stuff from heaven.
Amen.
And the Lord gave Mickey a word when I was reading. I said she liked it because the Lord showed her, told her one day, faith is the currency of heaven. When I heard that, I thought about you. I said, my goodness. You can get back where I'm at here. Remember who you are and whose you are. And remember God's promises. Now the other day you told me this here, remember who you are, whose you are, and what was the
purpose.
Your purpose. Remember who you are, whose you are, and what's your purpose. And if your purpose is, like I said a while ago, if you believe in your heart that God wants you to reach the world, if you believe in your heart that God has people out there that you want to minister to, well then why in the world are you going to let the devil stop you from getting there?
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
Don't shout at me because I'm preaching good. See, that's what we do. We know there are people that God wants us to reach. But so many times we give in to the things that the devil's trying to keep us from doing. We give in to the things that the devil's doing to us, trying to keep us from doing what God wants us to do. That's a mouthful for me. Amen. Are you here this morning? Remember God's promises. Like I said a while ago, Psalms 91:16. What does Psalms 91:16 say? The whole script, the whole chapter, you should remember the whole chapter, but Psalms 91:16, I know it, I don't have to turn. With long life shall I satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Yeah.
With long life. Like I said a while ago, 25 years ain't long life. I can tell y'all, Joshua was young when he left his world. 25 years. And we wasn't ready for him to leave. But he was ready. Was he finished? No, he wasn't finished. But he was ready. Go ahead and share this. She was standing right there beside Joshua's head, right here. This was when we was in the morgue with him. Joshua was right here. His head was right here. And we was actually went down there to raise Joshua from the dead. Found out he didn't want that done. But she's standing there and she's got his hands on him and she's praying in the spirit. And she said she seen Jesus in the right standing right there. You felt his presence. She felt his presence right here. And he said he's done everything I asked him to. Now you see he didn't say he's finished his race. He said he's done everything I've asked him to. But you see, I don't know why I'm getting off on this, but anyway, Joshua was wanting to go home. I don't know why. There's things that he's seen over there in Iraq that he could never get rid of. I don't know what he's seen. He never would tell us. But he wanted to leave this world. He really did. And I remember we was in Victoria, Texas, just south of Victoria, Texas. And we was believing God, and I was praying. We was praying on the way down there. And I know some of you have heard this. But we was praying on the way down there, and I began to remember a story that Brother Hagin told about an oil field worker that had gotten down in some oil field stuff. and basically killed him. And Brother Hagen, he was a deacon in Brother Hagen's church, and Brother Hagen was at the hospital with him, and he didn't know to do all this back then. He was still learning all this, but he said he found himself just saying, "God, I'm not going to let him go. I need him, and if I need him, you need him. I'm not going to let him die. You got to send him back. You got to send him back." And I told all that to say, I got a hold of that story, and I began to think about that. And I said, "Well, I'm not going to let Joshua go." And I began to say, "God, you got to send him back. Joshua, you got to come back. I'm not going to let you go. Come back. I'm not going to let you go. You got to come back." I was sitting right there in the front right seat of Larry and Casey's Armada, and I'm saying that. They ain't hearing me. I'm just saying it under my breath. I'm not going to let you go. God, you got to send him back. And I heard these words just as plain, and I knew it was Joshua's voice I heard. He said, "Dad, I don't want to come back." And it kind of drawed me up short. Because see, the whole time, I never knew he was dead until I got right out there. I found out they got in a wreck 125 miles from here. I had to drive all the way home. They was smart enough not to tell me that. But when I got here, man, we was believing God, but whenever I heard that, he didn't want to come back. So see, I thought about it a while, and I let him go then. But I believe with all my heart that if I would have insisted on him coming back, now I don't care if anybody else believes this or not. I don't know. I don't care. I believe it. I believe with all my heart. If I would have insisted on him coming back, he would have had to come back. Because if I hadn't, I wouldn't have heard him say, "Dad, I don't want to come back." Now, I know a lot of this is hard to believe, but we're talking about in the spirit room. You've got to get out into the spirit room. I'm telling all this to say, I know where he's at. I know he's there in heaven. This don't have a thing in the world to do with faith, with fear, but I just told you I'm following him. The day of his funeral, I got up my dance, man. I was dancing. Everybody probably thought, "Look at this idiot. There he is, the daddy of this boy, and he's up there dancing." I know these people thought that. Because my mind was saying, "Boy, you're stupid. You know, I'm just going to town, man. I'm dancing up there. I'm just really down." I mean, they judged the people that were there. I was down on it now. Singing that song, "I'm Free to Run." But you see, and I did that in faith. Because the week before when he was here, I don't know why we was talking about it, but he said, "I don't want people crying at my funeral. I don't want sadness at my funeral. I want people dancing at my funeral." And when they started singing that song, "I am free to run. I am free to dance. I am free to dance before you." It was like it just something in me just got up, man. I just went to dancing before the Lord and before you. And I seen this. There was an altar, and I mean not an altar, balcony. It was like a balcony above us. I seen this with my spiritual eyes, because my eyes were closed. There was this balcony, and I seen somebody go over in this crowd of people, and there was this, this all kind of stuff was going on. It was the reception part. It was receiving Joshua into heaven, and he goes over there and he gets Joshua by the shoulder and he brings him over to the edge of the balcony and he points down like that and he points at me. And Joshua, he just grins real big. Yeah, that's daddy. And then he goes back over into the crowd and begins to just, have a big time because he's going into heaven. But I said all that to say God did that just for me. And Joshua lived a good life. Joshua had got off on things. He was out, but he was so on fire for God when he got killed, y'all. Amen. And I mean to tell you, there ain't no telling what he's doing up there right now. Anyway, let me get back to my message. I don't know why I told that. Remember God's promises. Psalms 91, verse 16. With long, that's how I got off on that, wasn't it? Yeah. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. How to take him, let's see. how to take him on, how to, yeah, that's what I, how to go at him, how to start this, you know, he's out there shouting at you, how to go at him. Well, what did David do? One thing, David began to rehearse past victories. He began to talk about when the bear and the lion came and God delivered them into his hands. And he said, this uncircumcised Philistine ain't going to be no difference. Do you see, he went to rehearsing what God had already done. And he began to say, this joker here ain't no different than that bear. See, he's taking that joker down to size in himself. Instead of building him up, you know, oh my gosh, look at him, man. I know I got to face him, but oh, I'm going to go at him. God, look how big he is. No, he begins to rehearse what God's already done for him, and he begins to tell himself, that there, that's nothing. Do you see? He's bringing that down to size inside himself. You see, that's what happened to the people of Israel when they came out of Egypt before that, and they never got to go into the promised land. Why? Because they said, we're grasshoppers in their sight, and we're grasshoppers in our sight too. They could not see themselves going in and possessing the land because they seen themselves defeated. The Israelite army right there, they seen themselves defeated. They couldn't move forward because fear had gripped them so bad. They couldn't go forward. Wrote this. You fight the enemy with your words. You confess and you praise, and when you praise God gets bigger to you.
That's right.
You see, when you begin to praise God and you begin to rehearse what things he's done and you begin to remember the past victories, it may have just been an ingrown toenail that he healed for you. Begin to remember. Like you told about the Lisa's toe getting healed the other night. That's good to rehearse that, man. That builds your faith up. If he's done it for her, he'll do it for me. Amen? God's no respecter of persons. Are you hearing me? And I know there's times that we keep going and it looks like we meet defeat after defeat after defeat. We just, every time we run, it looks like we're running into brick walls. But it don't matter. You keep quoting God's word, you keep believing God. And don't dig your seed up or not.
Right.
Leave it in the ground. Keep believing. Keep believing. It may take 5 years, it may take 20 years. But it'll happen. If you believe it in your heart and you confess it with your mouth, it'll happen.
Amen.
It'll happen every time. It may take a lifetime. You know, I shared this story with y'all the other day about this fellow was driving down the road going home from the army. And he stopped and he was hitching a ride. This guy stopped and picked him up. And they was riding along there, and this guy was a rich guy. And he began to minister to him, began to talk to him. Make a long story short, he ended up getting the guy saved. Come to a point where the guy let him out. And he told him, he said, look, if you're ever in Chicago, look me up. He gave him a card. He said, if you're ever in Chicago, look me up. We'll go out and have dinner. 5 years later, he's in Chicago. He goes and he calls that number on that phone. Says, I want to speak to Mr. Champion. Said, well, Mr. Champion can't talk to you, but Miss Champion can. Said, okay. So she gets on the phone. He tells her, you know, 5 years ago, she said, how you know my husband? Well, 5 years ago, he picked me up on the road, and we was talking on, and he gave me this card and told me that if I ever got into Chicago, look him up, that he received Jesus that day. I wanted to go out and have lunch with him. And the woman got silent on the phone, went tearing up, went to crying. And she told him, she said, what day was that? He told her the day of it. And she said, well, evidently, after he let you off he got in a bad car wreck and got killed that very day. But she said, up until now, she said, I had prayed my whole life for him to get saved. And I thought he died without getting saved. She said, here it is, 5 years later, I've even quit serving God because I believe that God didn't save him, God didn't honor his word. Here it is, 5 years later, now he tells you, you prayed with him, he got saved that day. God's faithful.
Yeah.
God's faithful. You can believe him, and if you believe and don't doubt in your heart, you can have what you say.
Amen.
Don't let fear grip you. Don't let fear grip you. David built himself up believing on past victories. And Goliath said what he would do, but David said what God would do.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
See, the devil will come at you saying, well, this and that, this and that, and this and that. But you look at him and say, yeah, but God's word says this, and God's word says that. Find it in here what you can stand on and go back at him with his word.
Yeah.
See, the devil told Jesus, cast yourself down, you know, and Jesus, every time Jesus come back at him with the word,
right. Oh,
this joker knows the word. I got to go turn tails and run after 3 times. Amen.
Amen.
So that's evident. If you just stay with the word, it may take 3 times. It took Jesus 3 times, but the devil turned tail.
He did.
You stick with the word, the devil will turn tail. Because I got news for you. You've already won. You've already got the victory.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The master's already fought the fight for you. Amen. All you got to do is walk in it.
Amen.
Amen? Amen. Stand to your feet.